Hello students, welcome to Alfos e-learning senior intermediate English class. Dear students, in the previous session I taught you part of the lesson of second module, that is Opportunities for Youth, written by Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India. Many things we discussed in the lesson. Dear students, Opportunities for Youth. Thought without action is abortion, action without thought is folly. That we discussed. Okay, thought without action is waste, and action without thought is foolish. Next one is happiness is the inner state of mind. Happiness lies in what we are, but not in what we have. It is not related to the outside world. It's only an inner feeling. A rich man may not be happy. A poor man may be happy. It does not depend on the wealth of an individual. And we also discussed about the nationality. Every individual thinks about his nation. Every individual thinks about his nation's prosperity, his nation's greatness. Does it mean that the other nations are not great? One should not think like that. You, as an Indian, you can praise your country India, but you are not supposed to criticize other countries. That's what we have discussed. And the most important aspect we have discussed in the previous class is about Gandhiji. He had amazing qualities. He always picked out the best in others. Every individual has good qualities and bad qualities. Gandhiji mainly focused on good qualities of an individual. As he concentrated only on good qualities, the other person who had some bad qualities also felt ashamed of himself when he committed anything bad. What a wonderful virtue Gandhi had. We have to develop that habit. When we go to any foreign country, instead of criticizing that country, what is the main purpose of going to that country? To benefit yourself and to benefit that country. You think about that only. That's what we discussed. And in this session, let's continue, my dear students. We are all much too apt to look at the evil in other individuals and countries rather than the good. We are very much suitable to find out the evil in others rather than good. You see, the mentality of individuals, our mentality, you observe. We try to find out bad in others. Okay. Perhaps some of you know the saying in the Bible about the person who would not see the beam in his own eye and saw the mote in the other's eye. There is a saying in Bible, one cannot see beam in his own eye, and he tries to find out a small mote in others. The implied meaning of this particular sentence or saying is, a person may commit so many mistakes, so many grave mistakes or serious mistakes, he will never think about them. But when he finds a small mistake in others, he will highlight that. That is the mentality of human beings. When you show your finger like this, three fingers look at you, you observe. First of all, refine yourself. When you try to find a mistake in others, first of all, rectify your mistakes. That is the most important aspect. Okay, dear children, I'm sorry if you think I'm rambling. I express my regrets if you think that you are being confused. I'm not confusing you. I'm sorry if you feel like that. But this is, I might inform you in secret, a very clever attempt to get behind your mind. I am at least being frank with you. I am trying to understand you, and I am trying to make you understand. And at least I would like to be frank with you. That's it. I'm not confusing you. Okay, dear students, and next you observe. This is how I came to write The Discovery of India. So in this way, the author tried to write The Discovery of India. And before that I wrote my autobiography. Autobiography means an account of something which is written by himself or herself, which again was an attempt to fix myself in the context of the Indian struggle. He did not write anything about his personal matters. Again, he wrote about India and its struggle in his autobiography also. Actually, the book was more about the struggle in India than about myself. That's what I have just told you. It was pertaining to our country only. Of course, I was naturally a kind of central figure from my point of view, as everybody is from his point of view. He is saying very frankly that he is a central figure in his point of view, and obviously everyone is a central figure in his or her own point of view. I say that I am the central figure in my own way. One says that one is the central figure. So that is the thing. Then I wanted a larger canvas to think about, and I wrote Glimpses of World History. Wide publicity, wide view I wanted to have. For that I started writing Glimpses of World History. When we want to know about ourselves, first of all we should know about others also. So that is the thing. I am no historian, perhaps that was as well, because there are very few historians that I know who can think intelligently about history. So he is saying that he is not a historian. He says that he doesn't have much grip over history. And he also says that he knew some historians who had perfect knowledge about history. They are so full of facts and figures that they are overwhelmed by them. The historians obviously have abundant knowledge. They are overwhelmed with facts and figures. More than adequate, more than sufficient. They have knowledge, immense knowledge they have. Okay, and suppose they are lost in a forest and do not see some obvious thing because they are always crawling about in the underwood. Suppose they happen to go to a forest, they do not see the obvious things in the forest. They want to crawl, they want to move, and they want to observe. They go to underwent and they want to find out what is present inside. They want to find out the history of a particular wood they find in the forest. They want to find out the facts about that. In that connection, they miss the natural things. They are ignorant of natural things. Okay, dear students, then you see. I wrote Glimpses of World History in order that I might see my country and my age in the proper perspective of world history. I wrote Glimpses of World History. As I started writing Glimpses of World History, I knew about India also, because I started writing about the world. Eventually, I am supposed to have complete idea or knowledge or perspective about our country also. That is must. When we talk about others, we should know about us first of all. That's what I did. Next, you see. It was by no means a deep work, but it gave my thinking the framework of the world history. So it was not a great work for me, I thought at the time, but I could be able to write glimpses of world history. So because of which I could come to know about world, and at the same time I came to know about India also. Having got the larger frame, I looked more closely at my own country and wrote the discovery of India. Larger canvas, having larger canvas, and he started writing about India also. So because of which he could be able to complete the discovery of India. In it I concentrated on my country's past and the story of its development. What did he write in the discovery of India? India's past and India's prosperity and India's development. Okay, next. I am trying to explain to you how my thinking developed in these circumstances, in these attempts or in these matters. I am trying to explain to all of you, my dear young students. These are the words of Jawaharlal Nehru when he wrote this lesson. Now I am telling you the same. Please listen. The more I thought and the more I learned, the more I saw how little I knew and how much more there was to learn. The more I thought, the more I could be able to learn. And I also came to know the fact that how little I knew. When you are confined to a well, that well is a big world for you. When you come out of it, you can come to know how vast this world is. You may have some knowledge, but when you come and face the competition, where you are in competition, you can come to know. Okay. He also says that how little I knew and how a lot I am expected to learn. That's what he says, and of course that is applicable to us also. One of my regrets today is that I have no time to pursue these studies properly by reading or thinking or writing, because writing for me is essentially an aid to thinking. He expresses his regrets that he doesn't have time to read and write, as he is very busy with his political works. He expresses his regrets because writing is an essential aid for thinking. Whatever you think, if you put that on a paper, that becomes a great essay. That may become a great poem, an article, whatever it may be. You have to think and you have to write. That becomes eternal. Okay, dear students, in trying to write, one has to think more concisely than otherwise. In trying to write, one has to think in a brief manner. Whatever you want to convey to others, you convey that in a proper way. Then it will be comprehensive. That means it can be understood by the reader. In that way one should think. Okay. I suppose I must not complain of my present lot. He is saying, I must not complain about the present situation. What he says, let us see here. What I would like you to do, first of all, is to think. Develop the habit of thinking. When you think, you get thoughts. When you think wise, you get wise thoughts. Without thinking, how could you get thoughts? Dear students, please keep that in mind. Thinking is something which does not come automatically to a person. Simply, if you sit idle and see at the sky, you can't get any thoughts. Simply staying at one place, you can't get any thoughts. Thinking is something which does not come automatically to a person. Suppose if you solve a physics problem, you have to think about that concept. Just if you look at the problem, you won't get the answer. You should have perfect knowledge about that particular topic, then you start thinking, you get ideas and you get the solution. Mere looking at something, you will not get any idea because you become thoughtless. Instead of watching TV, better you read a book. Just if you watch TV, you watch, that's all, your mind does not think. Your eyes will be affected. You look at, that's it. But when you read a book, you start imagination. You will have imagination. In that imagination, your brain power increases. You will get different thoughts. Okay, dear students, you. Gossiping with a neighbor is not thought. If you happen to meet one of your neighbors and gossiping, unnecessary discussions, that's not a thought. That is futile. That is waste. That is not at all necessary. If you repeat something which somebody else has said, it is not thought. An answer is given by your teacher. If you by heart that is not your thought. Suppose I give you an answer. If you by heart that is not your thought. If you write an answer in your own words, that is thinking. Think and write. You will get the output. What I write, if you by heart, where is your knowledge? That is the thing. I do not expect all of you to become mighty thinkers, though some of you may. My dear students, the author says that he does not expect you all to be mighty thinkers. Of course, some of you may be mighty thinkers. Thoughts are different from person to person. Some people have extraordinary thoughts. You see, there are so many great people around the world. God has given equal efficiency to everybody. Brain is given to all. But how many people utilize that brain power in a proper way, in a proper perspective? Okay, dear students. But I would like all of you to think and to develop the art of thinking. It's my good piece of advice to all of you, my dear students. Develop the art of thinking. Start thinking. Okay. Nothing is more helpful to thinking than reading. That is, reading intelligently, because thereby you get another people's thought, and by weighing them you can think yourself. What is essential to develop the art of thinking? Reading. When you read, you can come to know the ideas of the writer. You take any subject. A book is written by an individual or a scientist or a person or a poet or a writer. First of all, you can read the ideas of that person and you start thinking. Then you can compare. In that way, you can enrich your knowledge. You can enhance your ability. Okay, dear students, and then I have often said that it is very unfortunate that people think and read so little nowadays, especially in India. The author says that it is very unfortunate that people nowadays are not at all thinking, not at all reading. Especially in our country, he has mentioned our country. Very unfortunate. They are not at all reading. What are they doing? We don't know. I do not call newspaper reading reading. If you read a newspaper, what do you read in newspaper? About Corona, you read. About Sachin Tendulkar, you read. About cricketers, you read. About gossips, you read. And you read headlines. You will have an idea about that. That is not proper reading. Read an article on economy. Read an article on agriculture. In newspaper also, editorial you read. You will have content in that. You can develop your knowledge. Gossips, sports and games, that will not value. Okay, and then you see. But any reading which makes you think is useful reading. Any reading which makes you think is useful reading. Suppose you read your optional subjects, physics or chemistry or maths, any other optional subject. You read the content. You read and read and read repeatedly. You can understand the concept. When you understand the concept, let it be any problem that is given, you can be able to find out the solution for that problem. So in that way, you have to develop thinking process. Even if it is a very good novel, great novels always make one think, because they are pictures of life painted by great minds. Any reading which is useful to you is good. Even a novel, because novels are written by writers, poets. They design the characters, they portray the characters beautifully, they present. If you read that, that will be useful to you. Okay, dear students, if you think about 5-year plans, you will find what a vital part the engineers play in them. So if you read 5-year plans, every time we can get, if you come to know about them, what an important role engineers showed or engineers played. We shall require tens of thousands of engineers. We shall require thousands of engineers. Engineers, different engineers. Civil engineers, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, even software professionals. You take many engineers. They play a vital role. Okay. And hundreds of thousands of overseers, hundreds of thousands and lakhs. Overseers means supervisors. All employees are very much necessary for the sake of the prosperity of a country. Country means people. People means especially you, that means you only. Okay. And the whole world is becoming more and more a world of trained people. The whole world is becoming what we call here more and more world of trained people. Training is very much essential. In two ways, they need to be trained in two ways. My dear students, please try to understand. They need to be trained in two ways. Number one, they must be trained in mind and have some vision and understanding of the world picture. We have to make them to know about the world. They should have a vision. What is going on around the world? Technology is immensely advanced at present, you know very well. So, to have an overall vision of the world, in that connection, they should be trained well. That is number one. Number two is, then they must be trained in particular job which they can do well. The particular job, let it be any job. All people are very much necessary for the development or for the prosperity of a country. Engineers are very much essential. Overseers are very much essential. Okay. Bureaucrats are very much essential. Doctors are very much essential. Take any other professionals are also very much essential for the development of the country. They must be trained in that particular job what they seek. Okay, That may be science or engineering or medicine or education. That's what I have just told you. That may be science and technology. That may be engineering. That may be even medicine. Even that may be teaching. Persons should be trained. With the training, they will come to know what is what. And to their knowledge, training is added. They can become more powerful. When people become powerful, naturally country becomes powerful. Country does not mean only the infrastructure and buildings, etc., etc. People. Country means people. People means especially young people. My dear students, please remember that. And therefore, such are the skills which will build India. Such are the skills which will build India. My dear students, please remember, such skills are very much essential to fabricate or to construct or to build our country. So dear students, please remember, a country can develop only when the people in that country are industrious, eminent in their fields, and diligent in their efforts, and sincere towards their jobs. Okay, then the country becomes prosperous. Okay, dear students, so this is the part of the lesson. In the first part we discussed, and this is the second part, and the remaining part we can discuss in the next session. I hope that you have understood very well. Dear students, I would like to give you a good piece of advice, that you read the lesson and try to understand the concept. If you read, you can easily understand. Develop the habit of reading. And finally, I express my gratitude to all of you for watching this lecture given by me. Thank you.